that anyone here at all takes anything away, it's something that he or she can do in their niche, or if the policymakers were here, like was planned, it's something that they can do for their people. We've been talking about leadership. However, I beg to add that followership does drive leadership. Complacency in followership, which is what you talked about, produces the kind of leaders you have, even in our homes. Let's start from our homes. I always say that the family unit has dissociated. That's why we are seeing the overall magnification of that effect. I use myself as a practical example. When I was growing up, someone came to my mother and said, oh, when are you here with you? What will I suffer? Your dad is late. Come on, go to Italy. Fend for the family. My mother told her, don't let her hear translated. And that is because I am my father's daughter. He brought me up with values. He instilled things in me that even hunger cannot take away. I know who I am. And that is how we should begin to raise our children. From the very beginning and say, look, you are you. You are special. You are unique. I go to work and people say, oh, where are you from? Are you in Nigeria? I say, yes, I'm in Nigeria. Largest nation in Black Africa. And I am from Benin. I've been out of the office. Was my great-great-grandfather. And they're like, what? I said, go to Google, you see. So I know who I am. My grandmother was in Calabar. You can't take that away from me because it was imbibed in me from when I was like that young man there. And this is what cultural integration does. My father was in the West for ages. So he knew that he had to come home. He knew that he had to tell me who I was. He knew he had to tell me what obtains in the West. Oh, may I call him over to a wepo? I knew that from the start. So nobody was going to come and then deceive me. So in essence, what am I saying? Stemming the time, knowing about this body. I mean, what is more graphic? This is Google in June, 1st of June 2017. 40 died of thirst in the Sahara Desert. I mean, it's graphic. UK deported 100 immigrants. And Nigeria, 1,060 Nigerians deported in 2 months. That's in South Africa up there. And in Libya, you can see more Nigerian migrants deported from Libya. For goodness sake, what is Libya? Who is the UK? What is US compared to Nigeria? So we all know that we have a burden. That's no news. We've all spoken about the drivers of this burden. I think Dr. Moro John was very able to elucidate the theories, so I leave it to him and we can remember his speech. But then we also need to realize that I put there all forms of poverty. And why have I said all forms of poverty? People often think poverty is when you haven't got food to eat, but that's not it. There is poverty of the mind, and there is poverty of the soul. There is starvation. I mean, this is a topic very dear to my heart. My dad died when I was in year 3 in medical school, so I know what it means to be hungry. And for a child who was brought up in affluence, I knew what that was. I rushed from pillar to post to pay my school fees. And do you know what the elders in Edo told me? Half of the men told me to come and sleep with them. Oh. And the other half of the women told me that they know what girls my age do. So I know what I am talking about. I was left in the open to try to die or survive. And I made up my mind, I needed to survive, and survive I did. But I did not survive alone. I survived with the aid of some good men and a few good women. And I made up my mind and made a vow that no woman will come to me hungry and go back home. That more men came to my aid than women. Forget that many of the men set out to sleep with me. I don't mind. But half of those who set out to sleep with me ended up helping me. And I didn't have to open my veins. So what am I saying in essence? Bring up your daughters to know who they are and understand their self-worth. If you know that there is greatness embedded in you, you won't even go anywhere in the first place, talking of being returned and being asked to be resettled. We need to know where we are coming from. And I'm glad that everybody has created the definition before I came. We now know who the migrants are. We know the voluntary ones. We know those who are non-strategic. That's what I call it, non-strategic migration. And then we know that those who return, they return in two droves, if we can divide them. You have those who willingly return as well, and there are theories for that, but I'm not going to go academic. I'm academic about 6 days of the week, so I'll just keep it to simple English. And there are those who don't want to return. Those who don't want to return are the deportees, the people who are just grabbed on the streets and taken onto the plane in a non-human rights. And how that there is no dignity. There is no dignity in deportation. I have been on the streets of Italy just out of curiosity. I have been on the roads in Italy because I want to know what happens there. And it is not funny. People put the money they earn from whatever they do in their stockings because they don't know when they can be sent home. You are picked from the street and you are taken right to wherever, the gulag, and then onto the place. In fact, the UK is the most, would I say, amiable place? Because yes. I'm on the streets in Europe and they're like, passporte, policia. I'm like, what in Ahu and Iwana?
Like in Germany. Germany.
Because I have problems here. You have the physical problems. Some of them have become unwell. You have the psychological problems. Many of them were even destabilized psychologically before they even got there. So when they get there, it becomes twofold. What do I mean? You are asked that you are going to Italy to do a certain kind of job, yes, for instance. And before you left, somebody had to test you to make sure you were suitable for that job. I am not talking from hearsay. I know what happened. And somebody tested you against your will. I'm talking of for the women. And then you then go to Italy. And then you are made to do things you never conceived could be done to human. I mean, that is psychologically mind-blowing. Prostitution is not an easy job. Ask any of you who is. It's a very, very challenging job to sleep with one man every hour. It's not easy. Then there are the social problems, there are the economic problems. But what I want to really, really bring out today is the difference between the willing returnees and the unwilling returnees. The willing returnees, they come into the country where they left willingly. So that means somewhere in their subconscious, they have severed all ties. So if I'm in the UK and then I decide that enough is enough and I want to go back, I'm beginning to sever those psychological ties I have with the UK. And I am moving on, I'm moving back. Whereas the unwilling person hasn't severed those ties. The person is still psychologically attached to Italy, UK, or Spain. That is why when you send people home, they do everything to come back. And then, of course, there is that societal stigmatization. People who go back unwillingly, many of them are labeled. You couldn't bring anything. You couldn't collect the sheep from the white man. It doesn't work that way. And then for those who also willingly return, there is the societal expectation. You were saying something about coming to bury your dad and they wanted you to pay because they thought you brought tons of money.
Yes.
So either way, whether you are unwilling or you are not willing, the society we live in is hostile.
Yeah.
And when you get back, it is even worse. You know, so where do you really stand? What do you want to do? How are we going to manage these people? And this is where I'm telling all of us that it starts before we pack those bags. It starts before they even get to the age of 5. It starts when a child is born. We need to speak to our children. I am my daddy's daughter and I am my mommy's daughter. I want to do something and I hear my father's voice and I don't. I was starving. I had no money. And a politician in Benin, I don't want to call his name. He put a bag of Ghana must go in front of me, filled with money. All I had to do was sleep with him. I had no money. I told him I couldn't do it. I got on a bike, and the bike carried me to Oba Market. When I got there, my mother paid. I had no money. But I did not have poverty of the soul.
No.
I did not have poverty of my mind because people had done their work.
Yes.
The society that raised me had done its work. So we are all sat here today saying, burden, burden, how do we help the government? The government, does the government make a woman go and send her daughter to Italy?
No.
It is the hunger that caused it, isn't it? Now, I do not expect everybody to have the resilience I have. And that is the funny thing. I am so compassionate. I understand what it means to go without meals and be hungry. So if I see people doing it, there is that compassion. However, I know that there's something more than physical food. Feed your children these things. Don't let them begin to pack those bags. Don't come back and look for V-boots. And you've been washing the floor. Then you gather all the money. Plus maybe your tax return. And if you see doctors that come abroad here and they go back home, they're very quiet. It's those who really don't have here in the UK or in Spain or in Italy that go home and make a lot of noise.
Yes,
that's true.
Absolutely.
So it starts before you travel. Don't get them to pack that bag. Managing the returnees doesn't have an end point. It doesn't. It's a process that continues. It's a slippery slope process. Don't think that, oh, we will then get the returnees in, we'll manage them, and they are gone. No, it's continuous. The government may manage them for a while when they start. CSO, civil society, and organizations may manage them when they start. But in our societies, in us, our brothers are coming back. We need to keep managing them. We need to keep psychologically boosting them, not cursing them every day. That is psychologically demoralizing. And there is no one size fits all. So if a deportee comes from China or one comes from Italy, you cannot just say, oh, this is a flat program for everybody. You must individualize their care. And that is left for a team of experts, people who do these things. And I've tried to divide it. I've told you about the family. I've told you about friend, family support. Non-stigmatization, no pressure. You don't keep asking them, what did you achieve? And then, for the government side and the group side, I have sat down and thought about it. And I have said, we need partnerships, something akin to public-private partnerships. You know, Western Union funds Igwe. Do we know that Igwe Festival, they do a lot of contribution.
Yeah.
Why did they choose to do that?
Because
people don't do what there is no gain. So let me tell you, they're doing it because they made so much profit from the beginning.
Yes.
Now they could have done more. Do you know that? If we actually had a proper representation, a proper force, and that's what we should be. We should be the bulldogs. It's not about going to do it well for Gidi guy in the palace. That's not it. It's about empowering the people. And the better empowered the people are, the more of an Ogidi Gal becomes.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we need proper partnerships. We need people who will come together with governance, banks, industries, public enlightenment, speak our language, go into the market. Tell these people that we want a proper state deportation plan. I put it down there. You can pilot it. Someone was saying, talking about Nigeria, and I like the way Joy answered that. You start from a small, the UK didn't become like this.
No.
If you want to go, go and watch horrible histories. There was a time there were no toilets in London.
Yes.
Okay. But you take a segment, you work on it, other people see it, and then they begin to pilot it in different places. And little drops of water are going to make a big ocean. You're going to learn from your mistakes, you're going to audit it, you're going to get better. Now, when people come back, if we had a state deportation plan, it would only flourish if we had a stable political terrain. I remember a lot of programs, Idiara and Ison, different things that have been brought by different governances and their first names. But what happens? What happens is that They come, they go, he changes his name, the first one is dead, there is no sustenance. No social cultural or family support as well. So an initial rehabilitation component should comprise of, or a state deportation plan should comprise of an initial pathway, you house these people, you feed them, you do all the health checks. And I'm very, very, very passionate about their mental health. Depression is real. When I went to Italy, half of the males were crazy. Yeah. No, it's true. It's not funny. In Britain, many people are swallowing happy pills. You know, it's something we need to look at. And then the second part, we need to then empower them economically. What are they going to do? We need skills transfer, continued education. Many of these people left school, though. They are educated. I asked them, who are we school for? Who are we born for? Why do we want to learn? I said, man, I didn't know you. I didn't know that's how it is. You have revolving funds, small business startups. And then the third part is the continued improvement for these people. But then, if you have a project like this, there must be transparency on the part of those doing it. There must be accountability. And there must be continued periodic audits, surveys. I know people love quantitative studies, but in this kind of things, I am a researcher, so I know it's of no use. You need qualitative work as well. So you must make the two. You must ask these people who came, what do you want us to do to you? And I think if we take anything away from here today, it is that when people return home, they return to a larger society. And even though we are calling on the government, by the way, we are all from here, to come and help. Need to start from our own self to help them. Thank you very much.
Any question?
Okay.
Can we just celebrate her and give her a big hand? And powerful delivery. Thank you very much. Clearly, you must have some questions for her. How many people have some questions? Okay, I've asked her to wait to answer a few. So let's take this first three. You first, I saw your hand first.
Thank you. Madam, first of all, welcome, thank you. What you said so far is so powerful, and I really enjoyed it a lot. But there's one thing that is missing on my way of thinking. I do go to Nigeria roughly 2 times in a year, and I stay in Benin there. I wear my shopping cap, I move around with food. People laugh, oh, this guy came from Benin with food. But I'm just trying to see how things are going. All what you said are so powerful. But the basic truth is that these things you said, they are on the air. Any street you go through is like a papa. Ibiwe, El Sakumba, El Tendina, Festinoa. They do small guys, they are on their way. As we are talking now, they are on their way. What I'm saying is that the enlightenment, the education is still not touching the floor. So we are suddenly talking about the governor. The governor cannot do it. We've got to look for a way. Because sometimes I go to Ring Road, I just stand with those people that are sending the child card. I'll be watching them. Every 3 small guests you see, they are discussing on how to go to Italy or how to go on the trip. So please, I don't beg everybody. I don't mind. I put my mom as well. Let the government at the top stage, let us be a kind of a middleman to sponsor things like advert.
Yes.
Papers, this newsletter, we just share it. Because now there's nobody buying this to buy in Benin City. Nobody, so they don't even know what is going on. We've got to go to the grass level, to the villages, share these papers. Employ people, once they wipe out, like, I'm sorry to use churches, they do carry a microphone and preach. There's nothing but when you go to Obamacare, announce it to people. And another thing we need to do, madam, or to the whole house, I will be a party as well. Whatever I know I can use to contribute, I will contribute. What is happening here? 80% of our Benin people are not saying it. There are some videos I watched, the way our guests are being useless. There was one I watched just last 2 weeks. I'm on night duty. biblically, throughout that night, my driving was I was not myself. When I came back, I told my wife, I said, this thing, we need to put this. What I'm trying to say, let me make it quick, short. Everything that is happening here that is not good, let's look for a way to make it clear to people in New Benin Market, or yes, so they can see face to face. Because this is our English, they're not the Yeramo. But when they share, or not clear, they share anger. Things go change. I tell you the truth, our English no go solve this issue. Just carry this video. Look for a way to show to one minute woman. Before you know the whole Obama market will learn by this thing. And the solution will start coming. When you tell a small child by there, come and go to Italy, you say, may I have home boy? So please, let's go back, go down to the grassroots. Thank you very much.
That's some sort of comment, as well as a question embedded therein. I think what we should do, you said everything we should do, I will not go back, but there's something I want to point out. Right now, I know of organizations that are working, and they are really working well. AWARE is one of them, Association Against Trafficking of Women. Sometimes you don't need to duplicate commissions. So what I'll do, I'll give you the contact of those who run AWARE, and then you can sell them this idea. They're already doing it, they go to the market and all, but they can do it on a bigger scale. We should learn to, someone said that earlier, work as a team. The bigger, the better. One room.
Okay, real quick, two more. Madam, sorry, I see. Thank you very much.
You've spoken very, very well. I quite appreciate your work. What I want to add to you, there are some of Benin men who tell their wife, it's not only our mother. Thank you. So our men too inspire these women to go outside.
Yeah.
Not only our mothers.
Yeah.
Our mothers, you know, mothers at a point of time they will be weak by age or anything. But if we are not one here, who are doing it? I will say 40, I will say 55. No, I call it the Ukraine, I am here. I am here. I am here. €200 is worth right now. But how you tell me? Say, as a budget, you love. So, if we are talking about that, you also address your government.
You would have liked it.
So, many of them come walking here when you are here.
Our mommy here has said that the problem is not only with mothers or women, that there are men, many men who send their wives abroad to go and prostitute or do anything and bring money back. Now, someone has really said that was dead, but I am going to beg to disagree because it's still ongoing. And don't forget, I told you I went to Italy. So, in addition to that group that send their wives to go and prostitute, there is the Shentromen. It is real. Eddie Murphy is talking and it's real. He may not be the best man. But it's real. I went to Italy and you know what they told me? Maybe what are you here who you go anywhere, don't you can't make me go with man. So that this was something said to me. So that means translated, the way the women have come to use their own nether regions to make money, so have I come to use my phallus medical terms to make money. So that means that they prey on these women. They make these women, they pimp them, and then they make money out of them. And how do we stop this? It boils down to the same poverty of the soul. It is only a shameless man that will send his wife to go and sleep with another man, be he white, be he black, and say, I don't care. And then they come back and they spend that money together. In the first place, if we educate our girls well, they know that such a man has nothing but hate for them. There's no love there.
Oh, yeah.
No, yeah.
There is no love there. So it still boils down. I appreciate your point, ma. But it still boils down to the public enlightenment. It still boils down to us talking to our brothers and sisters at home. Us not deceiving them, telling them exactly what it is like. Thank you,
Lord. All right, just the last one.
We have all been talking here and listening to all the story. But that's me. I start from my own story. I have never seen anybody, but we are all involved one way or the other. We are not here to look at the screen. You cannot tell me that you haven't lost a brother or a sister or a daughter on the same. So please, let me be honest with you. I had a brother, sister. Don't back me up. I have a nephew back home now. Now, I start as example with myself. He has been deported 4 times. Listen to me. I don't have anything with my sister. She is calling me. Don't leave me alone. I said, I'm not going to give you anything. The other brothers, sisters abroad, we're all exhausted. You understand? What do we do? Number one. That's number one question. This boy has cost me here in London to get enmity with 2 families. He created a lady, and then the daughter, I'm taking care of that. I'm taking care of that. You understand what I mean? So those are not pocket money. Please, everybody, we are all involved. I'm saying this now. You send money to your brother or sister back home there to come to abroad.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So what are we talking about here? You understand me? So please, whenever you are organizing anything, call me, I'll be there. But how do we tell them the right thing? When they I left Nigeria in 1976. You understand me? And I came here with 250 naira ticket. I started in Cyprus. I suffered.